more aware about different health topics from the professional perspective. And today, we're talking about phytochemicals, and antioxidants. And today, we're going to have Daniel Burgess, who will be speaking with us. Daniel Burgess is a second-year graduate student working on his master's of science in nutrition, which is awesome. I have a lot of friends who study nutrition. They're always telling me what to eat. That was fun, and I think that. He looks forward to being a registered dietitian and wants to focus his work on weight management. The past was helping us to diabetes prevention program groups and is working on developing peripheral for research study.
That makes it hard to study, I have 10,000 things, but we want to look at one thing, because we can't just look at, tomatoes, when you're doing nitty-gritty research. So what are some problems you guys can see doing research on phytochemicals?
Don't know which one had the effect.
Perfect. So she said it's hard to figure out which one actually has the effect, because you can't really isolate it. You can in research to give them an isolated compound, but it's hard when you're giving them like a tomato and saying this specifically is what is causing it. Any other concerns you guys can think of? Yes.
Don't they change based on the maturity of the vegetable or something? I've heard that a ripe tomato will have a lot more phytonutrients than a green one.
Yeah, so, for example, a banana. The green banana, when it turns into a ripe banana, it's a lot more processable by your body. It has more sugar And so when you have a green banana, it has what they call resistant starch. Has anybody heard of that?
No.
Correct. So it's something that's really hard for your body to metabolize, so you don't really absorb much of any of it. What about any other issues that you can have?
Soil is grown in.
Okay, so that's something as well. Soil. If you get all of your tomatoes, let's say, from Mexico, well, that's going to be different than if you get all of your tomatoes from Florida or some random other place. So that's something that can be problematic when you're studying phytochemicals. So that should clue you guys in that it's something that's really difficult to actually pinpoint one thing, this is causing that. So not a lot is known about that. But there are some general kind of categories that they've come up with. So there's isoflavonoids. Anybody think of those? What are those in? Anything? Okay. So those are typically in soybeans, I believe. And there's also phytoestrogens. Has anybody heard of those? Those are kind of big buzzwords. Okay. Soy, yep. So those are things that bind to the estrogen receptors. But typically it's a large dose that you have to have for it to actually have an effect. Anybody think of any other phytochemicals? Let's crank out some. There's a lot of them. Anybody? Has anybody heard of lycopene?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's one. Does anybody know what that is? So, yes, it is in tomatoes. What did you say?
It's out your eyes.
I'm not really sure about that, but it sounds familiar. Don't quote me on that one, though. So it's typically a colored pigment. So it's more of a red pigment. Has anybody heard of anthocyanins? Okay, what are those in? You have any ideas?
Blueberries.
Perfect, blueberries. Okay. So in this handout that we have, the rainbow one right here, so you have a lot of the colors, foods that fall in that, and then a few of the different actions and possible phytochemicals and what they do. So lycopene, that's an antioxidant. There's a lot of the ones that they do know about are antioxidants as far as beneficial phytochemicals. Anybody think of any antioxidants? Beta-carotene. Yep. Okay. And those will be found in what?
Carrots.
Okay, that's a good source. Any other things? So we're on the track. It's an orange pigment.
Orange.
Okay.
Sweet potatoes.
Sweet potatoes. Okay. And pumpkins.
No squashes.
Okay. Yeah. Well. Most of them, yes, most squashes. Alright, so what do antioxidants do? That's something that's really a buzzword out there. Okay, so it helps your body with oxidants. And what did you say?
Take care of the free radicals.
Okay, free radicals. So who here is familiar with free radicals? Okay, they typically are bad. There's some cases where they're good, but so most people not familiar with them? Okay. So who in here has had chemistry? Okay, lots of chemistry.
Long time ago.
Yes. So when you have an extra electron that is not paired, it's a high energy issue going on with your chemical structures. It can cause tissue damage. It can cause essentially, there is lots of It's a cascade effect, essentially. So what an antioxidant does is it helps to deal with the free radical. Can anybody think of a time when free radicals would be beneficial in your body? Yes?
To slow down the aging process?
To slow? Not necessarily. So a free radical would, in fact, cause essentially more aging, per se. But I was thinking more along the lines of immune system. Anybody thinking anything with the immune system? So it is a way in which the body, it's one of the defenses. So it can actually generate some oxidants, and such as superoxides and different things, and we won't go into that because that's a whole nother ballpark. But essentially what those do is they can attack the DNA of bacteria or something that is in your body, and so it's your body's way of fighting it. So it'll essentially affect the DNA of the creature, and then that causes it to be degraded because it can't reproduce and do all the different things. So that's one thing and one situation in which they're actually helpful. Can anybody think of another example of when they're helpful? I have one more that I'm thinking of, but it's kind of debated. So, in response to exercise. So when you're exercising, you're causing radicals. But your body can typically deal with it. And there's mixed research on if it's good or not to supplement with antioxidants after exercise, because they think that it might help with responding, one of your body's responses to exercise. So, okay, so focusing back on antioxidants and fruits and vegetables. So what are some other awesome fruits and vegetable traits?
Fiber,
okay. So that is one that is very important. What does fiber do?
Moves
through
your body.
Okay, helps things move through your body. Anything else?
Does it have something to do with water? How you retain water?
Okay, so there are water-soluble and there's insoluble fiber. And so the water ones will help, you know, hold water, essentially. So that's correct. What else does fiber do?
Slowing your time
by
so you feel full longer.
Okay. Yep. So there's weight loss implications. It can make it so that you feel full longer. So kind of a more satiety thing because you are not. It slows motility is one way of putting it. Anything else? We're looking for one major thing. Cheerios makes this.
Heart healthy.
Okay. So heart healthy. Why? Why is it heart healthy?
Because Cheerio says so.
Okay. They do. And they're not necessarily wrong.
Cholesterol?
Perfect. Cholesterol. Okay, so the fiber helps with cholesterol. So anybody know why Cheerios can make that claim?
It's a grain.
Okay, it's a grain. So there's fiber. And the fiber does what to cholesterol?
Lowers it.
Okay, so it lowers it because it, depending on the type of fiber, it binds to the cholesterol and makes it so that your body can't reabsorb it. So you end up passing some of the cholesterol. And then you have to make new. So it's kind of a way to get some of it out. So that's one awesome benefit of fiber as well. Go Cheerios. Any other fun, awesome phytochemicals that you guys can think of?
Folate.
What was that?
Folate.
Folate, okay. So folate, what does that do?
It's good for pregnant moms.
It is good for pregnant moms.
Neural tube,
okay. Any other ideas on what folate does? I haven't heard that one.
I thought I heard something about that.
Well, it wouldn't be too far-fetched because it helps with neural health, I guess is a good way to put it. So any others? Any other ideas? Has anybody heard of sterols, plant sterols? Okay, I'm seeing some nods and some maybes. Okay, so there's actually margarines that they dump tons of those into. Why would we do that? So you're kind of along the right lines, fat. So I'll give you a hint. Sterols. What sounds like sterol?
Cholesterol.
Okay, cholesterol. Perfect. So kind of works like fiber. It's another way to get your cholesterol down. Any other plant-based foods that you can think of, or nutrients, I mean.
Did you already say vitamin C?
I did not.
Vitamin C.
Okay, what does vitamin C do?
Immune system,
okay. Sometimes it can help with healing, depending on situations. Any other things with vitamin C you guys can think of?
Prevent scurvy?
It does prevent scurvy. There we go. I was waiting for that one. That one's pretty popular. Okay, so that's good. Prevent scurvy. We don't want scurvy. Any other nutrients? Anybody think of any herbs, maybe, or spices? I'll throw one out there. Cinnamon. That's one that's pretty popular. What does cinnamon do?
Okay.
So it has diabetic implications.
And an antioxidant.
Okay. See? Getting those wheels churning, we're good. let's see. Anybody think of any others that they want to bring up?
Cayenne and anti-inflammatory.
Okay, cayenne.
Cumin.
Cumin, turmeric, okay. So, any ideas into those? It's thought that turmeric might help with, it might possess anti-cancer properties. Still up in the air. most of the herbs are still being highly debated, so most of them are not conclusive as far as what they do and don't do. But a lot is known about cardiac implications for many of them. What about grapefruit? Grapefruit's something that interacts with a lot of medications. Anybody know why? Has to do with the liver. From what limited knowledge I know of grapefruit, is that it basically speeds up the rate at which the liver processes things. Don't quote me on that, but that's my understanding. And so that's why when you have medications, then it, yes. Anybody else? How about the other ones?
Does cranberry do a similar thing with kidney function?
I haven't come across cranberry too much in my readings.
Some medications you can't
take cranberry too.
Yeah, I know a lot of people use it for urinary things. I don't know if it's validated or not, but I have heard a lot about urinary issues. Potential kidney. Has there been any on here that we've missed?
Resveratrol.
Okay. So what's the best source of that? Okay. So red grapes. Or, you know, wine, because that's what they make it from. Let's go with the white wine. So what does that do?
Makes you feel happy.
Might not be the resveratrol. So resveratrol, it doesn't say on there, but it's actually an antioxidant as well. So it's actually a very powerful antioxidant. On here, it says that it might also decrease estrogen production. Okay. What about sulfides? Sulfur compounds. Anybody think
of? Lots of people are allergic to them.
Okay. And what vegetables typically have a lot of sulfur? Onions, okay. Okay, you're on the right track. Garlic?
No.
Thinking of two that look very similar. One's white, one's green.
Chives and.
Okay, well, that's that.
Oh, asparagus.
I was looking at broccoli and cauliflower. Okay. So all of the gaseous ones. So could it be because of the sulfur? Mm-hmm. All right. So what are some things that does? The organosulfur is in there. So that one they're thinking may have anti-cancer properties. A lot of people think that garlic helps with like antibacterial and things such as that. I haven't come across anything that's conclusive. Because yet again, there's so much out there that you can't really focus in on. So any other ideas? Immune function, okay.
I don't know if it's because you don't want to sit next to you because you're fat girl, because you stink, or.
There's also ginseng. That's one that a lot of people say. What's in ginseng? Anybody know what's touted about ginseng?
Something to do with memory.
Memory, okay. That's one.
Energy.
That's one that a lot of them. Energy is, I'd say, probably one of the most robust claims about ginseng. Any others you guys can think of?
Mm-hmm.
Green tea. Okay. So that's not necessarily ginseng, but.
No.
But what about green tea? What's in green tea?
Supposedly supposed to help with weight loss.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Do we know why?
Metabolism.
Okay. So.
Antioxidants of some sort.
Okay. So there's antioxidants. Okay. So green tea, we have antioxidants. It's supposed to help with weight loss. Potentially may slow metabolism. Any other ideas as to green tea? Because that's one that is very popular. Okay. So green tea also has tannins as well, has different acids. And I actually wrote down somewhere here about green tea. In which, of course, I can't find it. But it's okay. So, green tea typically, also from what I remember, has some sort of satiety effect. So, that is typically why they claim weight loss. What about cayenne or those spicy peppers, capsaicin? Anybody heard of capsaicin? Okay. Well, so what does that do? What's capsaicin responsible for? Okay. So it does do pain relief. Random fact: it's been banned from horse jumping contests. Because they have patches, and it makes them jump better, apparently.
Aww.
So, okay. So, what when you taste capsaicin, what does it feel like? Okay, so it's the thing that's responsible for the hot part of the pepper. And where is the most found in a pepper?
Seeds.
Oh. It's the pith, yeah, the white stuff around the seeds, okay? Which, that's something that not a lot of people know. It's typically the seeds, is what most people think, but it's the pith part, for the most part. So there's touts that increases metabolism. So if that increases metabolism, what implications could that have? Weight loss. Perfect. So, in my research on that, mixed reviews, of course, but there, if it does increase, then it does increase by about 50 calories. As far as, I mean, it's dose dependent, obviously, but typically for a high amount, you're only burning about 50 more calories a day. So is that enough to supplement with? Is that worth it? 50 calories. What can you get in 50 calories?
Yeah.
A fun size crunch bar. 50 calories right there. Okay. Any other ideas for fun, intriguing chemicals in foods? Should we talk about iron? I mean, it's not technically a phytochemical, but we can talk about iron. That's something that a lot of people know about, right? Okay, what are your iron foods?
Spinach,
okay.
Liver,
yes.
That's what I said too.
Okay. Okay. We're thinking plant sources, though. We're still going to try to stay on track with the phytochemicals. What was?
Raisins have some.
Raisins, okay.
We have wheat.
Cream of wheat, okay, yeah, that has some.
Molasses.
I'm waiting for the, what was
molasses.
That? Molasses. I am not sure about that one. What types of vegetables? Typically people, when they have
green
leafy. Bingo, green leafy vegetables. And then there's one that is pretty high in iron that not a lot of people consider often. If you go to a Mexican restaurant, you typically have this with cheese and a tortilla. Beans, bingo. So legumes typically have high iron. So what does that do for us? What does iron do?
A lot.
Okay.
You realize that when you're severely anemic.
Yeah.
Okay, so anemia. That's one fun thing if you don't have enough. How can we get more iron out of our vegetable-based diet?
Don't cook it? Eat it raw?
So that I wouldn't say would help.
Vitamin C.
Okay, vitamin C, perfect. So vitamin C is going to help with the iron absorption. Why? Do we know? So the best source of iron for your body to absorb is going to be meat sources. But you can still absorb some from vegetable sources. And vitamin C is helpful in absorbing it because of anybody? Okay. So it has to do with the property of iron. It helps it to stay in a oxidized state. So the iron that is in meat is already stuck in that conformation of iron, essentially, and so your body can absorb it. But the one in plant foods, it kind of is jumping back and forth and doing what it wants. So if you have vitamin C, then it makes it so that it is more easily absorbed and kind of reflects more of the meat iron. Does that make sense? So, what's something that we could do to beans in order to get more iron? So you said vitamin C. What's something we can add that has vitamin C?
Lemon.
I don't know how that would taste with refried beans, but.
Well, I think the taco with the lettuce and the lemon.
Okay.
Yeah.
Tomatoes. Perfect. That is exactly the answer I was looking for. So tomatoes have high vitamin C. So those help with absorption. Yeah, I think that's enough on iron. What else?
Well, so is gaining your iron from plant sources better than the meat sources?
No.
Like
meat sources is better for absorption. But if you are vegan or vegetarian, then there are things you can do to increase absorption. Everybody knows what I mean when I say absorption, correct?
I was just wondering, because it seems like there's so much information out there. Like, especially in America, like, we consume more meat than we should. So I was just wondering if it is better to, like, consume.
Aren't there some vegetables that actually have more iron than some meats?
Yeah.
There are some vegetables that have high amounts of iron, but it comes down to absorption. If you have 30 of one and 20 of the other, and you can absorb 20, then you can't absorb 20 over here. It doesn't matter how much was in this, right? So, let's see, what else? Instead of iron, what's another thing that we can talk about?
Magnesium.
Okay. What about magnesium?
I don't know if you're it's like the next miracle vitamin or mineral.
So your body does use magnesium a lot. What are some sources of magnesium? Figs. Figs have magnesium.
Multivitamin.
Okay. Multivitamin probably would have magnesium, so that's a good answer.
Yeah.
natural one.
Anybody know anything else that has magnesium?
Do bananas have them with their potassium or not?
Bananas are more of a source of potassium.
Okay.
So it's in a lot of things. Typically, meats as well. Meats provide a lot of things, actually, a lot of nutrients. So what's another nutrient?
Vitamin D.
Okay.
Sunshine.
Sunshine vitamin, okay. So what does vitamin D do?
Energy,
okay.
Bone,
okay. What else is involved with bone?
Calcium
and vitamin D. Okay, so let's go to calcium. What has a lot of calcium?
Milk.
It's the main source of calcium in the U.S. at least. What are some other things that have calcium in them? Fruits and vegetables, I mean.
Aren't potatoes a good source?
Of calcium?
Well, vitamin D.
I don't think so. Yeah. Typically, a good source of vitamin D is milk, eggs, some fish oils, certain sorts. Completely avoided nuts. What's in nuts?
Yeah.
Protein. Protein, okay. What else is in nuts?
Fat.
Fat, okay. Which kinds of fat?
Good fat.
Good fat, okay.
In moderation.
Right. So something we already talked about that nuts typically have a decent amount of are fiber. So nuts do help on multiple fronts. You have your healthy fats, and you have your fiber, and protein, and all that stuff. They are also a good source of magnesium.
Could you speak to the calcium in fruits and vegetables, like if you're dairy-free?
If you're dairy-free?
Mm-hmm.
I believe it's more of the crunchy hard ones. So typically,
like
broccoli.
Like root vegetables, too.
I'm not sure about root vegetables, but I know that like broccoli and those types of vegetables have more calcium. But typically, soybeans would probably be your best bet. But if you're, so from the dietitian standpoint, if you are being vegetarian or vegan, going for calcium, typically we would recommend like a fortified calcium soy milk or something to that effect. Because typically there's not a ton in a lot of other fruits and vegetables. Can we think of anything else? Have we exhausted our reservoirs? Okay. So I guess we'll conclude then. So as you can see, there's lots of things in fruits and vegetables. And as dietitians, we don't just typically push them on you for no reason. They do have a lot of health benefits. We do, as much as research needs to be done, there has been some done on cardiovascular disease, cancer, and osteoporosis, and those are typically the ones that research does suggest that phytochemicals do help with, but still it's being investigated and debated, but those are the promising ones. The cardiovascular health can be from fiber, can be from antioxidants, can be from cholesterol management or LDL management. And any last minute questions?
Do you know what the latest recommendation on vitamin D is as far as supplementing? I mean, it seems like it's going all over the place, and I've heard people still taking a lot of it, like 10,000 units
so,
a day and stuff.
It depends on where your levels are at.
Yeah.
Because you want to maintain.
Say you're low, like 27.
Like 20, you said 27?
27.
So 27, typically, I would say 2,000 units. Because you want to maintain. And it depends on activity level as well. So somebody that's more active is going to probably need a little bit more. I mean, not a ton more. It's not going to be like a huge, ridiculous gap.
Right.
But
2,000 is good for talking really needing to add.
Right. That's what I've come across. Obviously, I'm not a doctor, so I can't make the official recommendation. But that is what I would say is probably, from my reading, a safe bet. A lot of people do about 900. So it just kind of is what you dialed into, per se, as far as your body. But there isn't any... This is how much you need... Absolutely, that's it. Yeah. So.
It keeps changing.
It does.
When you read a vitamin thing and it says so many milligrams and it's 200% of RDA, is RDA based on a certain size of person or is it just
so,
in general or a different age?
So you're asking me how the RDA is
yeah.
made?
Well, the percentages, how does...
Oh, so the percentages on your vitamins? That's what you're asking?
Yeah.
So that's based on a 2,000 calorie diet.
Okay.
For like the daily value percent,
yeah.
I assume. Okay. Yep. Yes.
What is the latest on egg yolks?
On egg yolks?
In relation to cholesterol and coconut milk.
Okay. So egg yolks, there's latest research that came out that show that it doesn't really affect your cholesterol levels too much.
So it's okay that it's less than
that. Yes. Well, I wouldn't eat as much egg yolks as I wanted because it still is a source of saturated fat. And so there's total picture, you're looking at egg yolk. If you're trying to do weight management, might not be the greatest idea because you're trying to cut calories. Maintenance, not that issue. Depending on your cholesterol levels, I mean, not your blood lipid levels, that's a better way of putting it. So it just kind of depends on your situation. That's another thing that makes nutrition difficult, is that it's highly individualized. So in order to be like, oh, cholesterol from egg yolks doesn't affect me anymore, I'm going to eat 10 egg yolks. Probably not the greatest idea, but one a day, not a problem, type thing. Does that make sense as far as that goes?
I think even more than, correct me if I'm wrong, but more than one a day would be okay depending on the rest of your diet. So
right.
If you're not consuming processed foods and things with a lot of other saturated fats, then it's not really that much of a concern for you to have three eggs every morning.
Correct. It depends on your overall intake for the day.
Right.
Is the best way of putting it. And then you wanted to know about coconut oil.
Coconut milk.
Oh, coconut milk. What specifically about coconut milk?
It's high in saturated fat.
It is.
How about cholesterol?
The canned stuff, but what about like the drinkable milk substitute?
So, as far as coconut milk goes, That's one that's being debated, as all things. But do you want to know my personal opinion on it, or do you want to know?
Research.
Okay. Perfect. So research shows. That's why I asked for clarification. So research shows it is high in small chain fatty acids. Small chain fatty acids are easily absorbed in your intestine, and it can be easier on the intestine per se. So, like all things, moderation.
Is it high in cholesterol?
I don't believe so, but don't quote me on it because I haven't looked into coconut milk that much.
But the coconut oils are better than the corn oils.
Debatable. So I can't properly answer that question because I haven't looked into cholesterol levels in coconut. But I do know that it is a source of saturated fat. And so that will affect, you know, your fat level as well. Your lipid levels.
And what is your personal opinion?
My personal opinion as far as, it's more on the coconut oil, since I haven't really looked into the milk too much. But coconut oil is something that's highly talked about these days. And it's like the miracle oil.
Mm-hmm.
But it still is a source of saturated fat. So in order to say, oh, it's healthier than canola oil or, you know, some sort of oil that's a poly or monounsaturated fat, kind of a different story. So my own personal opinion is I would go with the other oils.
But
it does depend. Yes.
So you're not.
If you're frying foods, it has a purpose. So the smoking point's higher. So if you're cooking at a higher temperature, coconut oil can be beneficial because then it won't smoke until you get to a high level.
Does the smoke point introduce for apples? If you're going above that?
I have no idea, actually. I've never considered that. I know that, so when you get like your partially hydrogenated oils, those, they heat up a lot. And those are sources of trans fat because of the heat, which is, I assume, where you were going with it, but I don't know. Any other last minute pressing questions?
What if we eat, do they know that some people have to get out